several, in this case, biological organisms, but it can be also companies, or it can be also physical, either photosynthesis competing for the game medium, or many other but many other situations. The idea is to look at the competition between entities. So the competition means that there are entities that one needs some resource, the resource is limited, and then one of the individuals gets the resource, the other doesn't get. So there is a negative interaction between them because they share the same resources. And the simplest way, the first way to introduce competition is in this kind of models, with differential equation, is just say that the growth rate, which is the factor multiplying the density, has a negative dependence on the density. So that this growth rate, when the density is large, goes to zero. Fisher write it not for individuals but for genes, for the diffusion of an advantage gene in some population, but then Kolmogorov and other people did it for chemical reactions. So it's something that should model a kind of competition in space for diffusion entities that reproduce. That's the idea of the Fisher-Kolmogorov equation. So what's this equation has been analyzed for a long time, and there are many. The two most important facts about this equation is that first, rho equal to zero, so the empty space, no density, no individuals. This empty space is a solution of the system, so everything at zero, no density, is a solution, but it's unstable. So if there's any small perturbation, something will grow out of the empty space. And the second, there is a, in this case, with this parameterization, there is a stable state which is density at the constant. So it's a constant value which is called the carrying capacity. This is the carrying capacity, which is a stable state of the dynamics. In this case, it says all the system put at one is a stable state. The next important fact about this equation is that it supports strong propagation. Strong propagation means that if you start with some individuals in some part of the system and you let the system evolve, then this the number of individuals will grow and will not grow everywhere, but will grow extending from where they are already. A front that will propagate, and it is well known what is the velocity of this front with this equation and similar ones. So there is strong propagation. Which replaces the empty state, which is unstable, with the stable state. Okay, this is well known. This is the Fisher-Kolmogorov equation. It is interesting. There has been several ways of doing this in the literature, but it's interesting to look how can we reproduce this qualitative behavior written in terms of a partial differential equation, in terms of some more microscopic model in which you can add more ingredients. For example, with individual based models. So you have individuals that reproduce, that compete, and that move. Can we, what are the rules of motion, of competition, and of birth and death to have the Fisher-Kolmogorov equation? Then the simplest idea will be something like this. So those individuals have a birth rate and a death rate. The birth rate, it's a constant, minus something, which depends on the number of individuals around a given one. So this individual will look around, and if it has, counts how many individuals has around, and then compute this thing, and this is the birth rate. If there are many individuals, the birth rate will be very small. And also you can do the same for the death rate. The more individuals they are, the more the death rate will be. This can be implemented in several ways. For example, in the GSD algorithm, other ones in which you have the odd individual, you use a random one of them, and then decide with those probabilities what you choose, if birth or death, and then you go to the next step, and the next step in the algorithm is calculated with some exponential distribution. And you can do several things, but essentially is select the individuals and decide if you kill them or you make them to reproduce with those rates which depend on the population. And also, the way to include the mobility division is just to make in all the some time steps all the individuals to move with some division. To move randomly in a random direction that for the moment will be odd lattice Brownian motion. This is what of course, there are technical difficulties associated with this. For example, the growth, this birth rate can be negative if the number of individuals is too large. So it's better to put this function, the maximum between zero and this. So this is just a trick to make all probabilities positive if the problems are negative. That's a mathematical trick. And in all, you can introduce competition in the birth and the death rate, but in the following, I will put alpha equal to zero, so there is competition only in the birth. But again, this is not a real limitation, it's just to make the model specific. Okay, then you can see, okay, is this microscopic model with particles moving in a million reproducing what the is giving the same behavior as this more phenomenological partial differential equation that was the Fischer-Kolmogorov equation? Okay, for example, you can look at this. Okay, you see that the particles, each particle is moving, is reproducing, is dying with the given probabilities, and you see that certainly you see a front which is propagating, and this is more or less what is predicted by the Fischer-Kolmogorov equation, and also the density of individuals in this stable state is what is predicted by the Fischer-Kolmogorov equation. So this is more or less the same, it's a microscopic realization of the Fischer-Kolmogorov equation. But if you change parameters, for example here, you get something different. So there is a front again, but what is behind the front is not a stable state of homogeneous distribution of individuals, but something else. It's a pattern, it's a periodic distribution of individuals. So what has been changed from here to here? What has been changed is the relationship between two spatial scales. There was the interaction range, the range around each individual looks around to count the interacting neighbors. This is R, interaction range. And there is also some diffusion length that I will not define precisely, but it's more or less what gets homogenized because of diffusion in a short time. And it happens that when the diffusion length is larger than the interaction range, you have this situation. But when the diffusion length is small, the interaction range is larger, then you get this this pattern. Okay, in fact, this is not exclusive of the front propagating. You start with an homogeneous distribution, you also get this pattern problem. Instability, and so it's an hexagonal pattern.
No.
Well, they are growing, and at the final state, there is an average number, which is what you will see some graphics. On average, it's conserved, but there are fluctuations around. And in the initial stages, the changes can be large. So the basic ingredients of reproduction and death, mobility with diffusion and competition, can lead to the phenomenology of the Fischer-Kolmogorov equation, but also to something else. And then the rest part of the talk will be to try to understand what is this something else, why there are clusters of individuals forming, and what is the mechanism behind this. Before that, so this is some thoughts of what happens at different parameters. You see, when the diffusion coefficient, which is this limit, is large, then you see things more or less homogeneously distributed, and when the diffusion coefficient is small, is when you get this clustering of individuals in an external pattern. But when
microscopic model is given by
one part. It's a Brownian motion, so it's the. So each individual makes a step which is drawn from a Gaussian distribution and does this in a time step. And the ratio between the square of your displacement and the time step is what I call the distribution. I will change this later so it will be complicated. Okay, so this was in two dimensions, but there is nothing special in two dimensions. You can also do in one dimension, which here is plotted in X in the horizontal axis, and this is time. And depending on the parameters, you see that the population get extinct. So this is, there are clusters of individuals that finally all of them die in time, or you can have an homogeneous coexistence of those individuals for a long time, or if the diffusion coefficient is small enough, you have these clusters which are separated by a typical distance that evolve in time, sometimes more noisily, and sometimes really periodically arranged and quite stable. So this is the output of this particle model. Can we understand what is happening? And yes, after several years of thinking, this is the simplest explanation. But because the initial explanation was with equations, but now we understand what is the mechanism. The mechanism is quite simple. So imagine you have those particles distributed in space, and that by chance, by some initial perturbation, by some random fluctuation, you end up with a situation in which there are clusters of individuals separated by a distance which is larger than R and smaller than 2R. This is the situation. So there are these clumps of individuals which are more separated than R and less than 2R. In this situation, so individuals here compete among themselves, but individuals here don't feel the presence of the other ones because they are outside the range of interaction. Okay, so they can coexist happily because they are separated enough. They are at a distance larger than R. But what happens with individuals in between? Those individuals in between are competing with the ones here and with the ones there. So they are suffering double competition. So their resources here are being exploited by the two, and they will feel that. So those will immediately die because they have, so the birth rate will be largely reduced, or they will disappear. But if they disappear, those ones will have less competitors. So they will be enhanced, and the others also. So they will feel that those competitors are missing, so they will be enhanced. So the result is a positive feedback. You have that. If by chance there are clumps of individuals which are separated between R and 2R, anything between will tend to die out, and the two clumps will tend to grow. So this is a positive feedback that will make this initial perturbation that can be small, make it more strong. This is what is. This is the mechanism behind the formation of the clumps, which are, in fact, if you measure the distance, they are separated between 1 and 2R. That's what you see. There is something against this mechanism, which is diffusion. So this mechanism relates to the fact that the clumps are very well separated. If diffusion is strong, the individuals will move, and then all this space will be plenty of individuals, and then there will be no difference between the individuals here and the individuals there, because they will be moving all the time. So if diffusion is too large, the clusters will be wider, and then this effect will not work. You will have some flat distribution.
I miss the mechanism that makes them cluster.
No, they don't clash with them. You see, if there are some of them in the middle, they will disappear. Because they are competing with two sets of individuals. They're competing with more individuals than... So this one is competing with 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, and this with also 9, but those are competing with the ones here and the ones there. Which are more, and then they will lose.
So then there is no term
focusing in the individual. This is a condition that arises at random, and what happens after this is that this is not stable. They will disappear and others will go. What is stable is what you have seen later, is that clusters are formed, individuals separated. Okay? This was blah blah blah, this was hand-wavy. But this is the mechanism, and you can put this into equations. There are several ways of deriving equations for this system. We did this by some Boitelli focus space approach, but there are other ones. But what you get at the end is that the equation for the density has a diffusion term, has a birth minus death linear term. It has a competition term, but in the case in which the diffusion is large and these kind of things, then you get rho squared, which is the Fischer Kolmogorov equation. But if you take into account that there is a finite range of interaction R, then what you get is this rho times the integral of rho. This is a non-local equation, different from the Fischer Kolmogorov. The Fischer Kolmogorov is different, but in the local rho squared. And so this integral counts the density, which is in a neighborhood of size R around the point R, X. So at the difference with the physical mode of equation, this one is integral differential, and you can analyze mathematically this equation and see what happens. Of course, with this method, you can also get what is the intensity of the noise. But this is a complicated thing.
The birth
are probabilities, so it's a stochastic process. When you kill one of them or make them to reproduce by choosing between the possibilities at random with those probabilities. So there are fluctuations on this. And this first part of the equation you hear is deterministic, and of course there are fluctuations. Okay, this equation has been studied in the literature for some time. But with this equation you can analyze the stability of the, so you can see what happens with the empty space. The space is a solution, but as soon as you put some individuals there, they will grow, so it's not stable. What happens when you have a distribution of individuals which is flat? Is this stable or not? It's not stable for some parameter values. The standard way of doing it, this is to calculate the standard, so the flat solution, the homogeneous solution of the previous equation, let's call it rho 1, and then make a perturbation and put this perturbation to the equation, into the integral differential equation, and look how this perturbation grows or decays. Now, typical linear analysis. This perturbation grows or decays, you can show with these combinations of exponentials, and depending if lambda of all along values of lambda are positive, so they are negative, or there is some along value of lambda which is positive, then you can have growth or decay of this growth. This is the lambda, so this is what should be here, in one dimension and in two dimensions. In two dimensions there is this Bessel function, one dimension there are sinusoidal functions. And you see, so in both dimensions it's more or less the same qualitative feature. If by changing parameters you can go from a situation in which this lambda, this growth rate is always negative, meaning that so if you have a negative thing here in front of time, so any perturbation will decay, so the flat solution will be stable. Or when there is some value of lambda which is positive, then some perturbation will grow. Then this flat state will be unstable. And the transition between them can be achieved by changing several parameters, in particular when you increase the diffusion coefficient, you make all of these functions negative. When you increase the interaction range, you make this curve up. So
the difference, they analyze different
Well, you cannot see them, but it's different. In this case, this is changing this difference. But this difference between birth and rate, but you can also change D and you can also change R. So by decreasing D, you go up. So at some moment, this is the relationship. If beta is the difference between, is this net birth rate, so by increasing D or by decreasing, so by decreasing D or increasing R, you go into this situation, so you have instability. And then this is the explanation why there is instability going to pattern. And you can compute what is the critical wave number, and this gives a periodicity which is between R and 2R, the qualitative argument. Also, you can solve the differential equation in two dimensions or in one dimension, and you get the patterns for the equation. So this is the explanation of what is happening in this interactive capital models. You want to ask something? No? Okay, so this was the phenomenon found in the questions, and then the explanations with the questions and with some more unwavering arguments. Yes, this is very, yes, a reminder is that in the same way I am presenting this work as you have individuals moving space, in competing space. In the biological literature, there are other things which are a theory which is called the niche theory of ecology, or also related to evolution, which has some long history. But essentially, the essential ingredient in this theory is that you classify in an ecosystem, you classify the species according to some trait, some characteristic. For example, if you have birds, you can characterize them by the size on the size of the net, for example, which is related to what is the size of the seed they eat, and then this bird is eating this seed, this bird is eating this seed, and if you have two birds of more or less the same size, then they will compete for the same kind of seeds, and if they eat seeds of very different size, they will not compete, they have different needs, different resources. So the competition in niche states, which is the space in which species are located, will make some species grow, some species get extinct, and the mathematics of this is essentially the same as the one I just described you. You can have, now it's not individuals in space, but species in each space, so in some situations you can get clusters of species or quasi-species or that from a continuum of threads, not all the threads are alone, but you have clusters will be birds of this size and this size, but nothing. It is something that in some ecological situations should be seen, and there is a nice review here appearing in Theoretical Biology about this. The equation describing this is the same integral differential equation as before. But I will not talk more about this because in 2009 I gave a talk on this. You have here the presentation. So you look for clusters on our database and you will. Okay? But it's not registered, it's an old talk, so it's not recorded on here. Okay, so far what I've done, so this was as a model with competition, with birth and death, and with motion. And the motion was Brownian motion, so essentially this is Gauss, and so the steps, the particles were doing Gaussian steps, from 1999, and those are the trajectories. So the steps were taken from a Gaussian distribution. Mm-hmm. And as a consequence of this, if for three particles, not for the interacting ones, but for three particles, the mean square displacement of the particles is proportional to time. This is the hallmark of diffusion. What the next step we look at, and we did this with Els and Salu, who was a postdoc here for some time, and with Cristobal Lopez and other people, we did some work changing, so let's change the kind of motion to see if this competition mechanism leading to pattern formation is affected. Can we put some other type of mobility? And then we did Lévy flights. This is Monsieur Lévy. So Lévy flights are kinds of motion in which you have short steps and from time to time some large step, and all of this are drawn from a distribution which has a fat tail. So this is the distribution of the step size which has a power law at large size. So the effect is that you have a variety of length steps, and if you compute with this distribution the average square, the mean square of the distribution is even though you can define something like a generalized division coefficient, so the mean square displacement is infinity, but you can look at moments of the distribution which are small enough. And then you can see that there is a typical scale which is growing as time to 1 over mu, where mu is this exponent. And this is faster than diffusion. And this coefficient is something like a generalized diffusion coefficient. The point here is that since the mean square displacement is infinity, the diffusion coefficient is infinity, and in the previous transparency, you saw that when the diffusion coefficient is large, there are no particles. So perhaps it may happen that when you put this kind of motion into the system, since the diffusion coefficient is infinity, there will be no patterns because everything will be homogenized. This is something that can happen. And but if some of you are thinking that perhaps it's not so easy, and it's not so easy. So it's worth to study this kind of competition under this kind of motion. And this is the outcome. When you do Brownian motion, you get the clusters, which are before. And when you do the Lévy motion, you see essentially the same. Also, it's hexagonal pattern clusters. So there is pattern formation also with the Lévy motion. There are one quantitative difference. For example, you see more individuals in between those forbidden zones in which there is essentially nothing here. Here they can survive for some time because they move but they can jump very, very far and they can appear there for some time, but after this they will die, but other ones will arrive. So there are more individuals in between, but not many of them. Also, the colors here is a quantification of the distribution, so they are marked depending on the initial condition of the initial position of their ancestors, so they are reproducing, so they have offspring and offspring, and the color is the position of the ancestors. And this is more or less the initial condition was there were nine colors in looking at square pattern, and they more or less they diffuse only a little bit. Here the diffusion is much larger, so they go larger. So the cluster, the offspring of this cluster has gone to many other places. But anyway, apart from those important differences, the fact is that you can also have pattern formation in this case. And you can explain what is happening with the same kind of integral differential equation, replacing the diffusion term with a normal diffusion term, which is fractional derivative. Okay, this was changing the mode.
Yeah. Should that depend on dimensional?
We only have checked this for two dimensions. Why do you think it depends on the dimension? I don't think so, but why do you think?
Because the linear thing, so it's linear distance. And so you are saying that you go faster, so you move larger distance.
Larger?
You have to slowly move it closer to the square in this dimension as the cube. So
well,
that should be slowly in 1D and 2D.
Well, I haven't explained this, and I will not go into this, and the details are in this paper, but essentially what happens is that the fat tail of this distribution has to happen. In this kind of process, as soon as you go far from your cluster, you will die. You will die at the first step or at the second, but you will die. And then essentially the distribution is short tail. So in here, you don't have fast jumps. Here you have long range jump, but you die. So essentially you don't have long jumps. So essentially both are very similar. The point is that this...
But in 1D you would die less.
In 1D, I don't know, because I can think, but the point is that this infinite diffusion coefficient is something artificial related to the tails of the distribution, so the particles going very far. But when they go very far, they die. So essentially, you are not sampling this distribution. And I think this happens both in 1 and 2. There will be quantitative difference, but I don't think. I should recognize we haven't checked in one dimension. In fact, the analytical equations say that they are the same. Okay, so let's move to another thing. The previous thing was, so we have a competition model, and because of the mobility influences, you have a spatial pattern. Now let's turn around the ideas. Let's imagine we have some individuals which are exactly the same. They compete, so all of them compete exactly equally well. They have the same fitness for the resources, so none of them is especially good. And the only difference between them is that one move, for example, with Lévy flight, and the other with Brownian motion. So they move differently. Can this difference in motion make to them some competitive advantage? Of course, you know that, yes. Nature, the kind of motion of the individuals makes a difference. Can we do something, try to see something like this? Can we extract just a competitive advantage which arises only from the difference in mobility with all the other features of interaction exactly equal? This happens, so it's, which is changing the mobility type, even if they compete exactly equal, because of the special patterns that they form, there will be an advantage in competition. Let's see what is the idea. So let's put together Brownian, so Gaussian, and Lévy individuals, moving with the respective motions, but for the rest, they are exactly equal. They die at the same rate, they reproduce at the same rate, they count the neighbors of both types, or count the neighbors of Lévy or Brownian type in the same way. This was PRL just published with Els and Cristóbal. So will this make a difference in the outcome of the competition? Will some of them be better competitors because of the motion? And this is a summary of the outcome. What happens is that if both diffusion coefficients, so the ordinary diffusion coefficient is this generalized diffusion coefficient for the Lévy ones, if both are very large, so that there are no patterns, so everything is mixed, everything is homogeneous, then both of them coexist. The colors, red and blue, are for the different types of waters. But they coexist for a long time. In fact, at long time something else happens, but this is because of fluctuations. But see, for a long time you have this coexistence between the individuals. But when you change the diffusion coefficient or the relative or the generalized diffusion coefficient, the one you make, when you make one of them, one of the diffusion coefficients large and the other small, the one having the diffusion coefficient large dies. So in this situation, the Brownian individuals had a larger diffusion coefficient, and then they were eliminated. The Lévy ones win the competition. In this case, it's the reverse. When you decrease the generalized diffusion coefficient, they don't have the same units, so it's not just the ratio between them. I will show you what is the precise relationship between the diffusion coefficients. But essentially, the one that moves more dies. That's the rule in this. There are some strange situations where you may have the competition of them, but this is, I will not talk about this. This is a strange situation. In general, the one that moves more dies. Yes?
When you get the same result, if you compare two Brownian motions,
well, yes, I have, but if you have the two Brownian motions with one diffusion coefficient and another which is smaller, the one with larger diffusion coefficient loses.
You mean correlated in the figure which is in the top right corner, that k is larger than k mu?
Yes, but you will see the graph. It's because they don't have the same units.
In models, it is not clear, but in units, you mean that k is larger because they are.
And you will see what is the precise relationship, and it's essentially by if you put one of them fixed, one of the diffusion coefficients, then you move the other. If the other is sufficient large, it will die, and then you decrease it. There is a moment in which this one survives and the other dies. This is what you see. To understand this kind of competition, we haven't understand all the details of the competition because it's a non-linear interacting problem, very complicated. We don't understand all the details, but we derived the mean field macroscopic equations for the densities of the Brownian and the Lévy individuals. The difference between the equations in the diffusion term for the Brownian ones and some generalized diffusion for the Lévy ones. So this is the fractional derivative. And the competition term is just the counting of the two densities, so counting how many individuals integrating the two densities. But with this set of equations, we cannot solve them in the nonlinear regime, we don't know, but we can make the linear analysis of them and see when they, starting from some coexistence, which of the two grows faster. We can do this analytically. And it happens, so we get the precise, this is the precise relationship, that when this generalized diffusion coefficient multiplied by the critical weight number of this instability to the exponent mu, when this is smaller than the corresponding quantity for the Brownian ones, the Lévy ones grow faster. And the reverse happens in the definition. This is the relationship, so this is not that k mu is smaller than k, it's k mu multiplied by all of this. So this is what the analytical. So we only see that one of them grows faster and the other is slower. And this is more or less coincide with what you see in the nonlinear region. This is what you see. The blue region is the region in which the Lévy individuals win. The red or pink region is the one in the Brownians win. And this is the analytic prediction. So it's not perfect, but more or less this gives the qualitative difference between them. Of course, there is this strange coexistence region, but I will not enter into this. But essentially, this is the transition between the two explained with the equations. From more qualitative arguments, the explanation is more or less the same. The interaction between them is as before, but if you have individuals of one type that tend to move too much into this forbidden zone, the zone in which the competition is too strong, so the one moving more into the forbidden zones will die. And in fact, this quantity this combination of diffusion and distance is more is a flux. Is the amount of flux, so the quantity of particles per unit of time that exits a region of size the inverse of Kc. It's a flux out of some cluster, essentially. This is why the one that has more flux out of the cluster is dying. Okay, so this is what I wanted to say about this influence of mobility on competition and giving competitive advantage to one of the individuals or to the others. Now, transition to the rest of the talk will be fast. Let's introduce another type of mobility. Not the just mobility because they are doing self-motions or random motion, but because they are embedded in some flow that makes them to move. Okay? This is just a model flow in which you have it's a shear flow in one direction and then another one. So it's an alternating shear flow. We have been using this for many things. So you put those individuals at vector transported by this flow, moving one direction and then to the other, one to the other. And as expected, what happens is that if the flow is zero, you have the clusters, but if the flow is, this is the next one in the flow, then this one. When you begin to move the individuals too fast, then you destroy the clusters. Essentially what is happening is that with the more you steer them, the more you move them, it's like enhancing the diffusion coefficient, it's modernizing everything, and then you destroy the patterns. In addition to changing from pattern to new pattern, this is the obvious effect of the introduction of this another kind of mobility, which is external mobility, even by hydrodynamic flows. Also, there is some density influence. This is the density, this is the fluctuating density I was talking to some of you before. Fluctuating density when you have clusters forming, in this case, when there is no flow. And happen when you increase the flow, the mean value of the density decreases. If you increase more the flow, decreases. And then you go to this value when everything is homogeneous. When you homogenize it, not only you destroy the patterns, but also the interactions, effective interactions between them are changing. So they are effectively competing more, and then the density is decreasing. They are competing more because the flow is jumping the individuals to the dangerous zones in which there is strong competition. So they are distributing them everywhere. And in this case, they are not everywhere. They are concentrated in the areas of weakest competition. Okay, so these are the influence of hydrodynamic flow in this kind of interaction, and then this makes the transition to the next topic that will be short. More related to real data. So you see in the ocean there are biological entities and there are physical entities, and then this is a picture of temperature, a physical thing which is non-homogeneous, so it's distribution of temperatures in the globe. And also you see when you see from space the color of the ocean, then you can extract, for example, chlorophyll, which is the distribution of phytoplankton in the ocean. Then you also see that the thing is not homogeneous. Then you see that there are obvious inhomogeneities because of temperature. The poles is different than in the equator, but also you see something which is some structure which are related to the main currents in the world. The main currents, the Gulf Stream, look at this. The red and green colors are rich, so lots of plankton. Those things are associated to the currents, to the physical inhomogeneities, and this is another kind of inhomogeneity in the distribution of inhomogeneities in the distribution of organic organisms, which are related to the physical ones. And the physical ones are the motion of the flow, so it's interesting to look at the relationship between the inhomogeneities in the transport, in the flow effects, how do they affect the biological activities of the different species which live in between the sea. To do so, then we have to characterize the physical and the biological quantities we will see. Then for characterizing the physical steering the physical motion of the ocean, we will, this has been already presented in several books here, we will look for Lyapunov exponents, we will look for the distribution of finite size Lyapunov exponents. What is this? The idea of the Lyapunov exponents, to put particles in a place and see how do they separate. And the faster they separate, you see that the Lyapunov exponent at the initial place is larger. This quantity length will depend on the initial condition, on the initial time, and also how long you integrate or how, what is the initial separation. It happens that if you compute for each initial position a pair of particles which are close separated, and you color, so you assign the value of the Lyapunov exponent to the initial positions, you don't get a smooth distribution. You get something like this, a very intermittent distribution, but it's a multifractal distribution. So you see places where the values of this Lyapunov exponent is very, very large, and places where there is very low, and they are separated. You see typically the large values of Lyapunov exponents are in lines. And it happens that those lines are, you can see, for example, in this animation, that those lines really guide the motion of tracers in the flow. So this, you see those lines of high Lyapunov exponent, you see when those lines form closed structures, these particles which are moved by the flow, the particles remain inside the regions where the flow was, the regions where the flow was surrounded by the lines, and the tracers stretch and travel along the lines, some of the lines. Okay, this is something has been already talked about in several of the talks here, but it's just to show you that there is a quantity here, which is this Lyapunov exponent calculation, that when you map it on space, it tells you in which places you expect that the substances will remain there for a long time, or in which places the substance will be stretched and moved along particular lines. This is the idea of such calculations, and it's not only physics papers, but especially when there is some oil spill and these kind of things that appears in some other, this kind of, what is called Lagrangian coherent structures, these structures that govern the transport in the flows, appear also in non-very scientific papers, non-very scientific journals. Okay, you can compute such lines from several kinds of data. For example, this is computed in the south of the Balearic Islands, so the Mediterranean, from data from what is called altimetry, so data from satellites that look at the surface of the ocean to estimate the velocities of the surface of the ocean. Then we can compute the Lyapunov field, and you see that this real situation. The other ones, and okay, we can do it this from data, as in this case, or also from computer models of the ocean situation. Then I will show now two applications. So I've shown you how to characterize the motion of the sea with some particular quantifier. This is the intensity of this motion, the intensity of this turbulence, this, the intensity of this horizontal steering in several areas of the globe, in the Canary Island, in Benguela, which is South Africa. This is the intensity of turbulence, and this is the data from satellite of plankton. And you see, more or less, that the higher the intensity of turbulence, the smaller the intensity of plankton, and vice versa. When you have you see here that there is no plankton in this area where there is a strong turbulence. This is something we saw with Ben Sanguzzi and some people in Toulouse some time ago, and we have been working on this for a while, and now we have a lot of data on this. And so essentially this is the pattern we see, that this is the Lyapunov exponent intensity. When you increase the Lyapunov exponent intensity, you decrease the concentration of plankton there. And this is in the regions I've shown you before, which are what are called the distal boundary upwelling regions of the globe, the places where there is more plankton. The richest places in the world as for plankton abundance. Okay, this is the data, and then we have done several approaches to understand what is happening there, why is this, and okay, then I will show something, but essentially the idea that comes out of this is that in the places where there is a lot of plankton is because there is a lot of nutrients, in fact in those areas of the ocean there is a lot of nutrients coming up from the depth, because there are vertical upwelling currents, and there is a lot of nutrients there. The plankton is very happy there. If you have turbulence, like steering the thing and distributing everything, and probably making the plankton go out and making the nutrients go out, this will reduce the amount of plankton. This will be different in other situations that have also been reported in the literature. When you have the open sea with no nutrients, if there is no nutrients, there will be no plankton. And then it will be better if you steer, if you have some turbulence that brings something, some nutrients from somewhere else. Sometimes in the form of an eddy, a vortex that comes from outside, then there you can have enhanced production. But this happens in the open sea. So the open sea with no nutrients, it's better if you steer it. In the upwelling region where there are lots of nutrients, it's better you don't steer it, because you steer more, you will have less production. This is the qualitative idea. Going more quantitative, we have done several things. This is an extract of a paper just set up with Ismael and Pensan and Cristobal. So we did some model for the dynamics of nutrients, phytoplankton, zooplankton in the Benguela. This is the South Africa, the South Atlantic in the coast of Africa, with some interaction there between the three species, so the nutrients, phytoplankton, zooplankton. And we put the upwelling of nutrients in the coast of Benguela, as it should be. And if we calculate the fluxes, so what happens with the nutrients? Do they remain there, or do they go out? And we go, so that those are the fluxes, and the black line is the fluxes going out of this region for a realistic simulation model, which is called ROMS. And then the red curve is what happens when you reduce the resolution of the model, so that you make it less turbulent. It has less mesoscale turbulence to move the things around. In terms of the Lyapunov exponents, you get this. So for the full turbulent model, you have these lots of eddies and lots of turbulence. And when you reduce the turbulence, then you get something smoother. And so with the plankton. In the original simulation, you get lots of phytoplankton. This is the distribution, the filament of phytoplankton. And then when you have less turbulence, the flux is more concentrated. You have less export of plankton. By looking more quantitatively, for example here, this is the flux going out of this region through the vertical, in the north-south direction. When you have lots of turbulence, you have lots of export. This is, the flux is large. And when you reduce the turbulence, the flux is large. So this is more quantitatively the same as I told you before. In this region, in which the concentration of nutrients is high, the more you steer, the more you lose nutrients, and then the plankton will suffer. And some people were explaining this thing with three-dimensional models. We see here that it's enough to look at the two-dimensional ideas. The basic idea is here for the details, with the three-dimensional. And, okay, just to finish, I've shown an example, some model, not really a biological system, some model inspired in biology of interacting individuals, that you have some interactions that make them to live better or less, and mobility has an influence on them. Now we have moved to plankton, and then mobility, the ocean currents have an influence on them. As the last example, we collaboration also with Tenzan and people introduced some biologists in Gizeh and several places in France. We studied, and this paper, we studied this kind of bird, which is called frigate bird. They are all around the world, but the we studied the population which is living in this island, which is called Europe Island, between Mozambique and Madagascar. Our biology friends put transmitters in the birds to have the location from there. And at the same time, we have the characteristics of the mesoscale turbulence here. So this is the lines of Lyapunov exponents as a function of time. So this, the area is going south of this channel. And then we wanted to see if this turbulence, which is the bird trajectories, and in the background you see the lines of Lyapunov exponents, and okay, you can look at them, and it's not easy to see things, and you have to do statistics to see if there is some relationship between them or not, but in some cases you see that there is a clear relationship. For example, in this case, you see the trajectory of this bird, the red dots, and it's exactly following in top of this high value of Lyapunov, the lines of high values of Lyapunov. In this case, it's very clear, there is no statistic needed. In some other cases, you have to do some statistics. Then there are statistical tools to see if this, there is some relation or not, but the one that for me is more convincing is this. This is the distribution of the Lyapunov exponents. You see negative and positive because we calculate both in the forward and the backward direction. Essentially, what happens is that there is not strong steering, there is not a strong turbulence, the Lyapunov exponent values are close to zero, and where there is strong steering, then the Lyapunov values are large, either positive or negative. This is the statistics of Lyapunov exponents in all the area, so most of the values have small Lyapunov exponent, and a few of them have a large value. Remember that the high values are on lines, so it's a small fraction of the total. But if you look not in the pool area, but only at the positions of the birds, the thing, so you see that there is a depletion of the small values and enhancement of the larger values. So this is, here the values of the Lyapunov exponents are larger where the birds are, or better, the birds are where the Lyapunov exponents are larger. You can do more statistics on this, but the result is that those birds in fact follow, are flying on top of the places where the Lyapunov exponent is high. So as again another case in which there is an influence, a very indirect influence, because the water is not moving those birds. The water is moving nutrients and it's moving plankton, but phytoplankton, the phytoplankton is eaten by zooplankton, the zooplankton is eaten by small fishes, the small fishes are eaten by larger fishes, and those birds eat fishes which are not eaten enough. So there is a long distance between the motion of the ocean and the motion of those birds, but still there is an impact of the motion of the ocean on the behavior of the birds. We don't know exactly how are they detecting. I think they are not computing from satellite data the position of the line. Either they are smelling something which is transported on the line, or they are feeling thermal gratings which arise also at those positions. So we don't know exactly how do they detect, but the fact is they fly on top of those lines, and so those lines are something like the biological corridors of the terrestrial ecology, which the birds find the path to the. Okay, so this is what I explained. So in a variety of situations, from theoretical models of bugs or organisms, microorganisms that compute and move, to some more realistic and also more large scale situations, we see that the mobility of the organisms and the motion of the environment in which the individuals are is influencing the interactions between them, and the outcome of competition, and the possibility to grow, and then this is a place where physics and biology is one of the many places in which physics and biology meets. Motion is something with a physical thing, and then it's influencing the biology in many different states. So this is all I want to do.
In your the beginning of your presentation, when you showed the clustering, your competing competition mechanism is the integral to a certain radius over the density, that was binary. So competition, did you speak about this? Are you inside this box or are you not more inside this ring? If you have spatial dependency on resources, let's say the further you are away from a point, the less you deplete these resources, then you should get a an opposite effect.
Either to this talk or to the papers, and this is something that Cristobal and us a different thing with also with Damia working. We have not this. This can be thought as an interaction in which it's either you interact or not. So one of you can make something smoother, and you can characterize this by a function which depends on space. It happens in the ideal situations. If the thing is quite sharp, you get this effect. If the thing is relatively smooth, you don't have pattern change. And the transition is if you compute the Fourier transform of this interaction function, if it has negative components, you have pattern change. The mathematics. So you can derive the mathematical conditions. Essentially, this negativity of part of the Fourier transform arises when you have relatively sharp edges. Not completely sharp, but in fact sharper than Gaussian.
This is
what it is.
It's kind of related to that.
We
you said somehow that the birds that move the most are the ones that die the most. So in this case, like you have resources everywhere. But intuitively, in nature, you have more patches of resources, and you would think that moving a lot is good because you search, investigate more.
It is. This is why this is not really a model of that you can compare it with something real now. You have to do many things. If you want to justify this kind of model, you have to assume that the resources, when you eat them, nearly immediately they grow up.
Yeah.
In this limit, this happens. But of course, if they take some time, then if you deplete the resources, it's not good if you remain there.
I have a question to the same part. You started going to the homogeneous distribution of the two populations. And what would happen if you had a semi-plane where the one part is not popular in the beginning, but then the picture that then you find might have a strategic advantage, right? At least first populating.
There are fronts that move. Most of the times, there are fronts that move, and then one of the species invades the other. It's very clear when the one that wins is the Brownian one, you see, it's very clear. But when the one that wins is the Lévy one, the front is not very clear. You see jumps. It's a front which is not in the front. But essentially, there is something that is propagating in one of the views. There are situations in which the fronts don't really advance, and you get stuck there. Yes, there are some situations when the division coefficient is not very small.
But the winning population might change depending on whether you start with a homogeneous distribution or with the plane being entered.
We have not checked that. I guess that in some cases it can. I guess it can, but I haven't. We haven't seen that.
Any further?
Yes. Just to change to the last part. So but you see all these turbulences in the ocean, no? And they were saying that most of the birds were following some kind of
these
borders. But which is the interaction with the atmosphere apart from the thermics? Is there like the caverns of men and also growing this kind of crops?
The honest answer is I don't really know. And so I don't know if there's now more, but I know that there are gradients of temperature that might embed something happening in the air caverns, the vertical air caverns. But I don't know what is the full circulation around those lines in the ocean. I have no idea. It would be very nice to
there, like the air, like the caverns of air, has something to do with the formation.
So at large scale, when you run an ocean model, the wind is important. But there are winds which have much larger scales than this one. So it's very well known what are large scale winds, what are the structures that we use in the ocean. But when you look at such small scales in the ocean, what is the relationship of those small scales in the ocean with the small scale winds? I don't know, and I think it's not very clear. Okay.
Going back to the first part of the talk, I wonder about the role of the noise system. So you showed the equation for the time dependence of the density. And I wonder, since you already say you chose, or you are choosing the burden, that's right, randomly from a distribution.
Well, not exactly right. If we kill someone, or we make the, if we reproduce with some probability, which is given by the
range. Yeah. Right. But, you do not need for the metaformation, for example, the general trend of the system. You don't really need the noise of the system.
For the pattern formation, you don't need the noise. But of course, it makes a difference. For example, if you run the integral differential equation without noise, you get this nice, perfect, exact pattern. And if you run with noise, then you get something like this. So it's different. But okay, if it is more noisy, the transition points are not the same, so there are differences. But the pattern formation is not because of noise.
Okay.
Yes,
sorry.
Yeah.
Now, if I have questions, then thanks, Emilio.